So a new hair dryer is advertised and is being one of the faster hair dryer available. The heater in the hair dryer has a current of 6.75 ampere and the supply is 230. Show that the power is about 1.5 kilowatt. So how we can work out power, electrical power? It is a product of voltage and current, or we can say P is equals to VI. So when we multiply these two, the 6 point, so P is equals to VI, the voltage is 230 and the current is 6.75. So the product of these two will be 1550 watts, or we can also say it will be 1.5 kilowatts approximately. The next question: air enter the hair dryer at a temperature of 18. So this is the initial temperature. The fan in the hair dryer blows the air across with a rate of 0.048 kilogram per second. Like every second, this much mass of air flow over this coil of the hair dryer. Calculate the temperature of air as it leaves. So we need the final temperature and the specific heat capacity. So we have the formula: specific heat capacity is equals to energy divided by mass into temperature change. Or the temperature change, or we can also say E is equals to Cm delta T, where energy, because if you know the power and time, energy is the product of power and time, so in place of energy we'll have power into time is equals to Cm delta T. Or power is equals to C divided by Cm delta T divided by T, or C divided by T, M divided by T. So this is actually mass per second. So M divided by T is given to us. How much mass is there every second? P is the power, which we already calculated, which is about 1.5 or 15,000, 1550 watts. Specific heat is given. First, we'll find the temperature change. And because the object become hot, so the temperature change will be final minus initial. So first we'll just substitute the value. The power is 1550. Specific heat is 1.0 into 10 to power 3. The mass is 0.048 multiplied by temperature change delta T. So we'll work out delta T first, the change in the temperature. So that will come out as 32. And because we did not convert the unit, so if we convert the unit, because the change in degree centigrade is same as change in Kelvin, so the temperature change is 32 degree centigrade. So we have the th temperature change, which is 32. Final temperature we don't know, and initial temperature is 18. If this 18 is subtracted, other side it will be added. So 32 plus 18, that is equals to T2. So 32 plus 18, that is 50. So 50 degree centigrade is the final temperature of the air that will come out. Is it clear? Then state why the actual temperature of air as it leaves the hair dryer will be less than the calculated value. Because whenever a process is there in which heat energy transfer, it is not 100% efficient. So some of the heat energy from the hair dryer will transfer to the surrounding. So some energy will also heat the dryer itself. Some of the energy is used to move the fan, like all the power which we calculated for hair dryer, we calculated the power of the hair dryer is 1550 watt. But not all of the power is used to supply heat energy. Some of the power is used to move the fan inside the hair dryer. And even the cables inside the hair dryer will also heat up, so some of the power will be lost. So ideally, not all of the energy from the supply is used to increase the temperature. So not all of the energy is used to increase the temperature of air. That's why it leads to like smaller change in temperature as compared to what we have calculated in the previous part. So another question related to thermal physics. While underwater, a diver release an air bubble which is having a volume of 6.5 into 10 to the power minus 8 meter cube. At this point of a release of a pressure is 8.55 into 10 to the power 5 Pascal. The temperature of the sea is 5 degrees and the bubble rises to a surface where the temperature is 20. As the air bubble rise, the mass of air in the bubble remain constant, so number of particle does not change. Calculate the volume of the bubble as it reaches the surface. Assume that air behave as an ideal gas and the atmospheric pressure is 1 into 10 to the power 5 Pascal. So underwater bubble is released, which reaches the surface where the pressure is, the atmospheric pressure is 1 into 10 to the power 5 Pascal. This is a pressure at the surface, and originally pressure is 8.55 Pascal. So we have the formula that PV is equals to NKT, or because N is the number of the particle, K is a Boltzmann constant. What parameters are changing here? Pressure is changing, the volume of the bubble will change, and the temperature is also changing. So all the three parameters are changing. So we can say PV divided by T should be NK. Or when all the three parameters are changing, so we can say P1 V1 over T1 is equals to P2 V2 divided by T2. And whenever you're using the equation for ideal gas or the gas laws, the temperature should always be in Kelvin. So this is 5 degree centigrade at 273, so it will be 278 Kelvin. This is 20 degree centigrade at 273, so it will be 293 Kelvin. So when we substitute these values in the formula that PV is equals to NKT or P1 V1 over T1 equal P2 V2 divided by T2, so the first pressure that was 8.55 into 10 to the power 5 Pascal. That is P1. V1 is the first volume, which is 6.5 into 10 to the power minus 8. And T1 is the first temperature. So that is 278 Kelvin, because 273 plus 5. Where P2 is the second pressure, because as it reaches the surface, the pressure is same as like atmosphere, which is 1.02 into 10 to the power 5 Pascal. V2 is the second volume, which we don't know. And so P1 is the first pressure, 8.55. V1 is the first volume, and T1 is the and same thing. P2 is the second pressure, V2 is the second volume, and the temperature here, that is 293 Kelvin. So we substitute the values, like cross multiply, we will get the final volume of the gas when it reaches the surface, which will come out as 5.74 into 10 to the power minus 7 meter cube. So this is the final volume of the gas bubble when it reaches the surface. Then explain why the actual volume of a bubble as it reaches the surface would be less than what we have calculated. So in practical, what we have calculated in the previous, the actual volume will be less than what we have calculated. So what is the reason for that? Because we assume when the bubble reaches the surface, like here when it is released, originally the temperature was 5 degrees. And when it reaches us, the temperature at the surface of the sea is 20 degrees. But this bubble and will not have the same temperature. Temperature of the bubble will be different. Because this bubble is continuously in a state of the motion. So the final temperature of the bubble will not be exactly 20. Because if it remain there at the surface for a longer period of a time, then it will come in thermal equilibrium and it will have the same temperature as the temperature of the water at the surface. So bubble is not in thermal equilibrium with the surrounding, or bubble is not having like reaches thermal equilibrium means like no heat energy transfer in and out. We call that as a thermal equilibrium. So the final temperature of the bubble will be less than 20, as the bubble is not in thermal equilibrium. That's why or bubble at the surface will not have So its temperature is different, that's why its volume will be different. Is it clear, this question? A microwave oven uses electromagnetic waves to transfer energy to certain substances such as water. The frequency of electromagnetic wave generated in a microwave oven, that is 2.45 gigahertz, the wavelength of a microwave. So we have the formula, the wave equation V is equals to F lambda, where V is a speed. All the electromagnetic wave, they travel at a constant speed, 3 into 10 to the power 8 frequency. That is 2.45 gigahertz. So it will be 2.45 into 10 to the power 9, because giga is 9. And wavelength we don't know, so we need a wavelength. So we divide the 3 exponent 8 divided by 2.45 into 10 to the power 9. That will give us 0.122 meter. That's a wavelength. The next part, a teacher determines the efficiency of a microwave oven. She places a glass beaker which contains 225 grams of water. And keep in mind, if the specific heat capacity is given in joule per kilogram, then the mass should be in kilogram. If the specific heat is joule per gram, then the mass will be in gram. So it means we divide by 1000, so it is 0.225 kilogram. She places a glass beaker which contains 0.225 kilogram of water in oven, and then the input power is 550 watts. The microwave oven is switched on for 120 seconds, so that's a time, the temperature increases from 15 to 67.5. If we want to calculate a temperature change, so temperature change in Kelvin is always same as temperature change in degree centigrade. So without converting a unit, I can work out the temperature change. Like, because if I calculate a temperature change, I just have to take a difference here. So 67.5 minus 15, so it will be 62.5. And it will be 62.5 degree centigrade or temperature change of 62.5 Kelvin. That's the same thing. Does not make difference because it is a temperature change, not the temperature. Like, we are not saying 62.5 degree centigrade is equals to 62.5 Kelvin. We are saying change in degree centigrade is same as change in Kelvin. So we have to calculate the efficiency. So first we should know this is an input power. So we should know how much power is there for to heat this. So we have the formula: specific heat is equals to energy divided by mass into temperature change. So first we'll find the energy, or we can also say E is equals to Cm delta T, where the specific heat is 4190, the mass is 0.225, and the temperature change, that is 52.5. By mistake here, I wrote 62.5, this is 52.5. So this is 52.5. So when we multiply, E is equals to Cm delta T, the multiplication of these all will give us the value of energy. So that is like 4.9 into 10 to the power 4 joules. But we need the power. So power is equals to energy divided by time. So energy we already calculated. Because either or we can also like use the efficiency, like useful energy output divided by total energy input multiplied by 100. So instead of converting this energy into power, we can also convert the given power into energy. So the input energy will be input power multiplied by time. So input power was 550 and the time it is 120 seconds. So that is 6.6 into 10 to the power 4 joules. Now to calculate the efficiency, efficiency is a useful energy output divided by total energy input multiplied by 100. So efficiency, useful energy output, that is 4.9 into 10 to the power 4, total energy input 6.6 into 10 to the power 4 and multiplied by 100. So this process is 75% efficient. Is it clear, this question? Then the last part, state a reason for efficiency less than 100. What is the reason why it is not 100% efficient? Because practically what happened, not all of the energy is transferred. All of the microwave is not absorbed by the water. Some of the microwave is being reflected, or some of the microwave being absorbed by the other material around it. That's why it is not 100% efficient. So, and so one mark you can just mention, all of the microwave are not absorbed by the water molecules. So not all microwave energy absorbed by the water molecule, that's why it is efficiency is less than 100%.